I thought today I would like to actually just do a very, very high level and general discussion and chat about connectivity and about the path of publishing, publishers, where we are in this country, what we are up to, and to tell a little bit about the story about TISA Black Star as well and what I've been doing there for the last 4 years. I've been there for 4 years now. We are, as Tim said, we have about 7 newspapers, magazines, 14 websites. You know, we publish titles like Business Live, Business Day, The Sunday Times, Dispatch, Herald, Financial Mail, Times Live. We've got 2 of the biggest news sites in the country, Times Live and Sowetan. Combined actually have the biggest digital audience, actually a bigger digital audience than News24 now. But because they're on separate URLs, we don't count them quite in that way. And our group audience digitally is now double what it was 4 years ago. So we were actually under 4 million UBs a month 4 years ago, and we are now over 8 million. So, you know, we've grown incredibly on a very, very steep curve. We've been working with Jellyfish for the last year, I think, maybe a little bit longer than that, on a variety of different products and projects. And a lot of that has been, I'll touch on this a bit later, but a lot of that has been around understanding audiences, how to understand what is happening with our audiences, our data collection. We were collecting data, we had and doing nothing with it because we didn't really understand what to do with it. So I'll get onto that a little bit now. We've also focused very, very hard on product and technology, and have completely rebuilt every single one of our websites during that time. So we're really in an extremely good space. In fact, a couple of our products won awards at the Digital Media Africa Awards yesterday, which I'm delighted about, including a runner-up prize for Freya Virkblatt, which is our latest product that we put out this year. I don't know if you've seen it. But we're doing some really interesting stuff in paid content, in thinking about very, very deep verticals, niche audiences, as well as the very big mass market sites and audiences. So I've had a look through the guest list, and there's an amazing collection of people here today. And I'm sure that we are all interested in the same thing, which is basically like, what is digital and what does it really mean? I mean, what is it such an odd word? Because what does it really mean? Is it like something electronic, or is it like a process, or is it a big change thing, or what is it? But I thought it would be quite nice to start with a bit of trivia before we get going, which is, if you could think back to 1998, and I'm sure some of you were about like tiny at that stage, or maybe not even. and to prompt you a little bit, this is what was the top of the hit parade. I Don't Want to Miss a Thing by Aerosmith, and Cher's Believe. Do you remember that? Anybody? So this is what did not exist 20 years ago. Wi-Fi, 20 years, okay. Google, which was founded in late 1998. Any social media, right? So no Facebook, Twitter, LinkedIn, etc. No podcasts, no PayPal. No Wikipedia, no Netflix, no Bluetooth, no Kindle, e-readers, or YouTube. Okay, that was 20 years ago. Things that didn't exist 10 years ago, that was 2008. These were the top of the hit parade, in case you need to remember a bad night out somewhere. I Kissed a Girl from Katy Perry. And Viva La Vida from Coldplay. Okay. iPhones. Actually, 11 years, so I'm a little bit off there. But basically, 10, 11 years ago, no iPhones. We did not have a smartphone in this world. iPads and tablet computers, GPS on phones, Google Chrome browser, which now has 60% of the market. Snapchat, Airbnb, Spotify, Instagram, Kickstarter, Lyft, Uber, Pinterest, blockchain technology, and Bitcoin, and 4G. Okay? 10 years. So you can, you know, the pace of change that we're talking about is so phenomenal and so fast. I mean, it feels like those things have been around forever. But actually, every single one of those things has massively disrupted an industry in one way or another. And I mean, that's something that we have to get our heads around. What does it mean for our industry, our staff, our customers, our future, and for our kids especially? So I want to here to talk about a little bit of this with a focus on publishing, because it's a fascinating example of how an industry can be turned on its head, like the music industry, the photographic industry. What we have been is not what we shall be in the future. And we don't even know what the answer to that question is right now. The main thing really is, though, do we have a business model to sustain that? And the only thing we can really do is do our very best to make sure that we're in a good position to try and keep up, to capitalize, and to advance up the scale of digital maturity and make sure that we are where our customers are. So I was at the Financial Times in London for 12 years, And I had a unique position on the sidelines of watching a massive newspaper like that with a 125-year-old heritage change from being a predominantly print product with very, very print-centric advertisers and products to become what is now really a digital power. It's a superpower in terms of digital because it is the first and most successful of all of the big newspapers to become a digital organization. They now have more digital subs than they do print by a factor of sort of 4 out of 5. And the editor, Lionel Barber, always used to say that we have seen more change in that newspaper in the past 15 years than in the 110 years before that. And that's, again, like a, you know, just an idea of how fast things have moved. I've called my talk this morning, When Will It Stop? And really, that's just because it's one of the most common questions that we encounter all the time when we are working in our own organizations, when we're trying to work with change management and trying to get people to understand about the changes that we're making. The answer to when will it stop is never. It's just going to get faster. So that unpredictability is going to be driven by machine learning, by AI, algorithms, things that we don't even know about yet. It's the Donald Rumsfeld, the unknown unknowns. We don't know what they are. We've just got to try and keep up with them. I had a colleague at the FT many, many years ago, and I still feel sad when I tell the story, but it was very indicative of the kind of journey that I've had, certainly in my own career. We were moving onto a new system. We were given new equipment, and one of those things, this was probably 15 or 17 years ago now, was a mouse with a right-hand mouse button, because before that they didn't have those. And I was, he probably had a couple of pints at lunch, and I had to sit down and help him to do something. And I said, you need to click the right-hand button of your mouse because that's where all of your menus are. And he just looked at me and he said, young lady, I've never used a right-hand mouse button. I'm not going to start today, and I'm not going to start ever. So I was like, oh, great, okay, great. So that really was just like a very good example of the kind of change management that we were going on. He took a package, he left, okay. I mean, the fact of the matter is, you know, you can't do your job unless you are going to be prepared to change. That is one of the main things that we need to be able to teach people to do. But in our industry, like many of your industries, we've had a lot of casualties along the way, let's face it. And in publishing, that has led in many cases to a juniorization of newsrooms, a leeching of experienced reporting staff, editing staff, et cetera, et cetera. That's partly because of financial pressure and partly because of the unbelievable technical change that we have experienced over these years. So what has happened? What has changed since the days of millions of newspapers being shipped out across the globe every morning and evening in a flurry of human effort, a massive industrial logistical undertaking, reporting, writing, illustrating, printing, selling, delivering, flying, trucking, hand delivering, two doorsteps, a perfect capsule of news, opinion, and entertainment every single day? Well, I think one of the main things really is connectivity, which is the theme of today's talk. It's the confluence, for me, of three enormously powerful forces, all working to different ends, but resulting in a perfect storm for the publishing industry. And that are, these are the invention of the iPhone, number one, wireless and connective infrastructure, and Facebook and Google. So I think those are the things that I just want to run through, if that's okay. Firstly, the iPhone. It's just now, it's one of thousands of varieties of smartphones. I mean, we were looking at some stats yesterday. Android, Google phones outsell iPhones by a huge factor. I mean, it's absolutely massive. In Africa, Africa has the highest penetration of smartphones in the world. I mean, smartphones or phones. I mean, people don't have computers and laptops and tablets. So it's a mostly very unique mobile environment. And for the first time in their lives, people can hold in their hand a tiny little computer with all of that amazing power. And actually, the first contact that most people have with the internet in any form is Google, because if you have an Android smartphone, the first encounter you will have with the internet is through a Google interface. I mean, I remember being on maternity leave and sitting away from work for the first time, I think, in my life, and I had an iPhone, and I thought, gosh, it suddenly occurred to me that I was stuck at home, but I was doing everything on a phone. And the dependencies that we have on our phones are unbelievable. I mean, like, let me just run through them, because if you think about this, I was ordering nappies from Amazon. putting doctor and health visitor appointments in a calendar, booking appointments online, looking at budgets in Google Docs, online banking, WhatsApping, posting photos on Facebook, ordering groceries and clothes online, paying bills, donating to UNICEF continuously because I would watch their ads on morning TV and I couldn't stand seeing all of the sad and crying babies because it made me so heartbroken. So I donated a lot of money to UNICEF, and booking flights, an endless list of dependencies. And that is really where we are, you know, with that dependency with our iPhones and our smartphones. Of course, also reading the news, which is something that somebody of my age still does. A lot of people don't read the news anymore. Or they don't get their news via normal news sites anyway. Secondly, having ubiquitous Wi-Fi in developing countries means that the distribution of news is instantaneous and it's absolutely lightning fast. So for newsrooms, that means for where hundreds of years we've worked to a deadline of once every 24 hours, we now have a deadline every few minutes. Okay, so you can understand the phenomenal amount of change that that brings to us. We're instantly reaching millions of readers in a very few short minutes, obliterating all the systems and processes that have defined publishing in the past. And the implications for change management in these institutions is absolutely monumental. A word of caution, I learned very quickly when I came back to South Africa after being in London for a long time that having a smartphone does not mean the same thing to everybody. And for those of you who are involved in marketing, I'm sure this is on top of mind, but it really does need to be with your product strategies, with the way that you're thinking about things. There is smartphones in South Africa is often a meaningless term because people do not have access to the internet. They spend an astonishing amount of money on data. Data is violently expensive. We should all be locked in a battle to try and get data costs down because the cost of data in this country is fundamentally affecting your business and your ability to grow. And I think that that is something that we should all be cognizant of and thinking of all the time. There are millions of South Africans out there who are making a choice between having data and eating, okay? And that is really not the way that it should be. We should be pressuring all the time on this factor. The other thing is app swapping, which is something we don't really comprehend. If you're sitting with your top of the range iPhone and your, you know, 5G or Wi-Fi in your house, people don't have storage on their phones. So your app is not necessarily there all the time. It's being swapped out continuously for something else because a lot of the smartphones that are being sold have got very, very small amounts of storage on them. And that is just a fact of life in this country as well. So not everybody is like you. Whatever you may be, but just think about what's going on. I've often repeated a quote that I can't attribute, but it goes something like this. I've heard it somewhere along the line. In the future, wealth and prosperity will not be divided between the haves and the have-nots, but rather between the connected and the unconnected. And that is more true in South Africa, I think, than anywhere else I can think of. We are working with a very interesting partner called Binu. I don't know if you've heard of them, but they're deeply focused on data-free products, which I have a very big interest in. They've got a messenger option called Moya that already has 1.2 million users that's grown just in the last couple of months. And this is, again, feeding into a society that can't afford or doesn't want to pay for data. Definitely worth looking into this. We have an app on there called SA News Live. Last month, we did 356,000 UBs on it and about 47 million page views, which is unbelievable. But that's because it's data-free. This is how much people really value being in a data-free environment. Finally, Google and Facebook. The duopoly, as we call them, have had vast implications for publishers on a number of fronts. First and foremost, these tech giants are literally sucking up the lion's share of digital advertising. So when we all get very excited in publishing to hear about how digital advertising has grown, what that really means is the slice of the pie for us has not necessarily grown at all. Digital advertising means that all of that advertising is going towards Google and Facebook predominantly. Amazon is coming up, taking about 12% of that market now as well. So they are growing quite considerably. The reality is about 61% of digital spend globally is going to Google and Facebook, and rumor has it that the number in South Africa is north of 75 or 80%, but it's not really confirmed. Nobody can actually say for sure. The fact is, these are massive engineering companies. They have sophisticated data collection. They've got management systems that mean, on data, that mean that they're able to target advertising at such a granular level that for clients, for agencies, for anybody, really, the ROI is so attractive that it can't be overlooked. As publishers, this is a very hard truth for us. We are not massive engineering companies, and at no point in our existence had we thought about doing anything other than telling stories or reporting on the state of the world. So understanding a reader's preference for Colgate above Sensodyne was never really on our radar, and we're paying the price for it now. The irony for us as publishers is that even with our very well-respected brands, we're actually having to get to know our readers. Can you imagine? And this is one of the many journeys we're taking with Jellyfish as we work on our data strategy, start to understand how people are using our sites, what they like and what they don't like, et cetera, et cetera. The advent of digital has definitely brought us this opportunity, and the intelligence already that we're getting out of some of the upgrades and some of the work we've done has been phenomenal. So I'm really excited about that. We have had to learn how to make our content more attractive. We've had to play the game of algorithms, search rules. We've had to understand what discoverability actually means, search engine optimization, and try at our very best to be at least a player, if not a winner. And I think that is something that we are all battling with. We have spoken a lot in the industry about publishers' cooperatives, to be able to pool our data and to pool our inventory, to actually be able to compete in a genuine way with a Google and Facebook duopoly. And we are still working on that. I mean, what we really do need is the support of clients and agencies to actually be able to make that work, which is what I'm getting to. What does it all mean for us? So publishers are under massive pressure. There's no doubt about that. Advertising has declined radically in print format. The pressure on pricing in digital, especially since the arrival of programmatic advertising, has ensured that we will never be able to run newsrooms on this revenue alone. It's just never going to happen. We're making inroads on improving programmatic execution, again with the help of Jellyfish, and on paid content, which we've done a huge amount of work on that. But in a country like South Africa, it is morally difficult to charge people for news in an environment when they need to know the truth, and we need to pay our journalists. So this is one of the conundrums that we face on a daily basis. How do you monetize news, and how do you actually keep your newsrooms running, and how do you give people what it is that they need? Advertisers and clients are moving budgets to programmatic and digital advertising, and I'm sorry to say, but in many cases, getting a high ROI on spend does not necessarily mean that your adverts are ending up in a brand-safe environment or reaching the intended recipients. We've seen many, many cases of this. For those of you who are advertisers or clients, please make more pay attention to what your agencies are doing with your money and make sure that it is going where you think it's going. The public is very willing to support independent media like the Daily Maverick, which is quite correct. They're doing unbelievable investigative work. I'm sure you saw Paulie van Veks' piece this last week, which has had a huge amount of airtime. But the mainstream media, like Tiso Blackstar, for example, like Caxton, which rely on advertising and subscriptions, is also working unbelievably hard to keep the train on the track for freedom of press, the exposure of the situation in South Africa. We published approximately 400 or 500 stories up to and including the Gupta leaks. It's a story which was broken by the Sunday Times and resulted in the end of Jacob Zuma's presidency and the establishment of the Zondo Commission into state capture. The freedom of the press and democracy in this country is absolutely fundamental, but it is driven and supported entirely by advertising and subscriptions. Those are our revenue streams. Our journalists are harassed and harangued on a daily basis. For them, their digital journeys include a trip through the troll-infested wastelands of Twitter every day. Okay. But we will continue and we will forge forward. And a quick glimpse into the future, and this is really, I think this is our multi-moment moment, which we're hoping to get to at some point. Robo-journalism. So, AP, which is one of the biggest press agencies in the world, they put out thousands and thousands of stories every day, is now publishing 3,000 stories a day that are not written by human beings. They're written by robo-journalists. What that is a combination of very, very solid data and spreadsheets and lots of templates that interrogate that data and craft a story around the data, insert appropriate figures at the right time. So things like house prices, things like currency reports, market reports, company stories, all kinds of stuff. You can't even tell the difference. Okay. So that's going to bring some interesting challenges for us, I'm sure, in the future. But also lots and lots of opportunities. It's been great to speak to you this morning. It's actually my second digital journeys because I did make it to the Shard in London last year, which was fantastic. And I think we've actually possibly got a better view in Joburg with all of these beautiful trees. And I wish you a very, very fruitful day. Thanks, guys.